The East End was still a bomb site, but life thrived with a cheery defiance, especially among children. Here we see children at the Fern Street settlement in Bow. The settlement was and is a charity, and by tradition, local children small enough to pass through the wooden frame were given toys in exchange for a farthing. These were known as the Fern Street Bundles.
Over 50 years ago, when Miss Grant became headmistress of an infant school on Bow Common, she found the people there were so dreadfully poor. Most of them were out of work, and there was no money to buy toys and various things for the children. She made up her mind she would try and do what she could to help, and she appealed to her personal friends. And after a time, they sent in parcels of toys, clothes, books, all sorts of things that would help.
Job. Two men from a branch bank by taxi to the head office, the money chained to the wrist for safety against snatch thieves. But this day made history even in these times of audacious robberies. The taxi had been stolen. The thug at the wheel knew what time the bank men would make their weekly trip. Suddenly he turned into a disused yard. Waiting there, other gangsters coshed the passengers, locked them up. Another perfect robbery. Mail gang in 10,000 raid. London bandits grabbed 13,000. 20,000 raid on London Bank. That one was in Stoke Newington High Street. Through a back window, the bandits took oxyacetylene gear, forcing the bars with heavy bolt cutters. A Euston Road shop, though not this one, had sold such cutters before the raid. Something about the buyer made the assistant take the car number. His action led to an arrest. In a Brixton street, another snatch. Clapton post office raided. Bank stick-up at Brentford. But what of the victims? How little we hear about them. Is it any wonder that people are asking, oughtn't bandits to get the cat? Wouldn't that stop all this coshing? No bandits ever raid peaceful Whitehall, where the Home Secretary says the cat would put the clock back 100 years. Mr. Butler gave Pathé News an exclusive interview.
Sir, why are you against flogging people who rob with violence?
Well, originally flogging was done away with in 1861, that's about 100 years ago. It was kept for crimes with violence up to 1948. Then it was abolished by the then government in the Criminal Justice Bill at the time. And since then, the crimes for violence have actually gone down. And now they stand at less than they were in 1948.
Do you intend to increase the police force?
We are getting more recruits, and of course I should like to see more still. But I think it's even more important to make best use of the forces we have. Now, some people say that there are too many on traffic duties. But in fact, we have analysed that, and I don't think there are. You see, the road traffic accidents, in fact, account for more loss of life than anything even that the criminals do. And so we must keep a balance between the two.
Postal institutions correcting the young offender early on result in many of them going straight afterwards. Isn't it possible that in the long run this treatment will end robbery with violence?
You expect miracles.
And who are you?
I'm John Capstick, ex-chief superintendent of the Criminal Investigation Department.
Ah, one of Scotland Yard's big five. And what's your solution to the problem?
Well, you know, thieves that commit violence, they should be flogged with the cat. They understand that. I have known in all my years of experience these thieves that have had the cat, and my word, they never come back for a second lot. You know, they much prefer a double sentence of imprisonment to that cat of nine tails.
Do you think the police are doing enough to combat this violent crime?
Well, they're doing well, but they can jolly well do much better. I think the powers that be should take the policeman away from summoning the motorists for obstruction. And what I would personally like to see are the women police do such duties and relieve the men to suppress the crime.
When the money for the annual share-out was drawn, the Elephant Loan Club hired a bodyguard for the secretary. Why don't big firms do the same? The money had reached headquarters. The members were certain to get it. Or were they?
The Royal Standard is a pub in Bethnal Green, London. Nothing special about it, nothing special about the folks who go there. Just an ordinary pub and ordinary people. Except for once a year, one day out of 365, when all the regulars have a hen party, club together, pack up for the day and go for an outing. And this is what they do. The time of their lives, once a year. A couple of Cherubins are taking them to Southend, but that's a long way, and there's nothing like an outing to give you a thirst. So they pull up at some shady spot off the road. Mum doesn't get much of a chance for a holiday in the ordinary way, but Father can cook his own dinner today. That's the idea of an outing. A day when you can get away from everything. Be yourself among your friends. This is Mother's big day. Father has his own club, his own cronies, his own pet haunts to go to when he wants a change. Why shouldn't Mum have a change too? That's what these folks thought. So that's why once a year they pack up their traps, leave the washing up till they get home, go out and enjoy themselves. That's what an outing's for. Bit of a change, this, from queuing and trying to get a seat on the bus with all the shopping. And when it's time to go home, that's what they'll feel they've had. A bit of fun, a bit of a change.
And each dream that I've dreamed came true. I remember with pride how we stood side by side. What a beautiful picture you made as my bride. Even though silver crowns your head, I can still see the gold ringlets there. Love's old flame is the same as the day I changed your name. When your old wedding ring was new, we'll be right back. I remember with pride how we stood side by side. What a beautiful picture you made as my bride. Even though crowns your hair, I can still see the gold ringlets there. Love's old flame is the same as the day.
I was at the Children's Hospital at Hackney, which is, I think, called Queen Elizabeth Hospital. And I was there, my first job was a junior casualty officer. It's a very fundamental thing, this thing, thought of somebody being trampled to death. I mean, it's another thing you could think of them being burnt to death, for instance. But these were not, there was no question of that. They were actually human beings that had trodden on other human beings. They were completely trapped. They could not escape from this staircase. We just received one dead body after another. And I can remember very well opening one of the doors of the doctor's consulting rooms and saying, you know, let's put the bodies in here. Just stack them, roll them off the stretchers. You couldn't possibly have casualty littered with bodies. And these bodies were sort of obviously asphyxiated. They were sort of pale lilac in colour. But it was perfectly obvious that the women were actually trapped. I mean, many of them, it was interesting how many of them had their arms in this sort of position. And I think it was because, A, they were holding the children or their bedding or something. And they were so cramped, if you understand my meaning, that they couldn't presumably extract their arms. When you stop to think about it, it really was simply horrific. But one of the serious things was the ambulance men, who usually were sort of so sensible and cooperative about things, they were quite hysterical also. Afterwards, when I thought about it, I realised that it was because their wives and children spent the night in that shelter. And they all knew exactly where the disaster was. So the bodies were moved. I can remember hearing the sound of the vehicles that came to fetch them. Because, I mean, they had to go somewhere to be identified. So the rest of the night we were there working. And ultimately the next morning we were told that we could go off duty for 24 hours. This is the two students and myself. And that we weren't to tell anybody. And they made it quite clear that we were absolutely sworn to silence. And I think that had a very bad effect, generally, I mean, on many people. Because I can remember very well ringing my mother, who at that stage lived in Streatham, and the next morning I told her, you know, that I had a terrible night and been dealing with casualties and absolutely nothing had happened to me, I was perfectly all right. Because I thought instinctively that it would be on the radio, not television in those days, but the radio. And of course nothing was mentioned. And I never actually, for the rest of her life, I never told her what happened. Because I actually was so shocked. And I didn't tell anybody or speak about it for 50 years.
They sheltered in tube stations which were preferable to the Anderson shelters, which ripped apart easily in a blast. There, in the warm draft of the tube, people slept on the platforms while the bombing raids rumbled overhead. Some played cards or talked. Most slept fitfully. Occasionally there were disasters, like the crush at Bethnal Green. But on the whole, the tube offered a sanctuary from the destruction of London. Nevertheless, the East End was defined by strong community ties. And the population was surprisingly resilient. Propaganda films played on this, creating a defining image of the chirpy, cheery Londoner.
Phil Bean stands up. Oh, Bob's my uncle, thumbs up. Phil Bean's Bob's my uncle, thumbs up.
But while the image of the brave East End was broadcast across cinema screens, it was necessary to boost the morale of those who suffered nightly bombing raids. Winston Churchill began visiting the East End on a series of expeditions. He had hardly been in the East End since the famous siege of Sydney Street. Instantly recognisable with his trademark hat and cigar, his visits endeared him further to the weary population of the East End.
Every week, to my readers in the United States, a dispatch about how you people all over Britain are fighting the war for democracy. Last week, I sent a dispatch about your capital, London. It was a new kind of a dispatch, a film dispatch. Here it is.
I'm speaking from London. It is late afternoon, and the people of London are preparing for the night. Many of the people at whom you are looking now are members of the greatest civilian army ever to be assembled. These men and women who have worked all day in offices or in markets are now hurrying home to change into the uniform of their particular service. The dusk is deepening. Listening crews are posted all the way from the coast to London to pick up the drone of the German planes. This has been a quiet day for us, but it won't be a quiet night. They'll be over tonight. They'll destroy a few buildings and kill a few people. Now it's 8 o'clock. Jerry's a little bit late tonight. The searchlights are in position. The guns are ready. The People's Army of Volunteers is ready. They are the ones who are really fighting this war. The firemen, the air raid wardens, the ambulance drivers. Here they come. Yet the People's Army ignores the bombs and the spent shrapnel which rains down on us. Brokers, clerks, peddlers, merchants by day, they are heroes by night. The night is long, but sooner or later the dawn will come. The German bombers are creatures of the night. They melt away before the dawn and scurry back to the safety of their own airdromes. London raises her head, shakes the debris of the night from her hair, and takes stock of the damage done. London has been hurt during the night. The sign of a great fighter in the ring is, can he get up from the floor after being knocked down? London does this every morning. London doesn't look down upon the ruins of its houses, upon those made homeless during the night, upon the remains of churches, hospitals, workers' flats. London looks upwards toward the dawn and faces the new day with calmness and confidence. The People's Army go to work as they did in that other comfortable world which came to an end when the invader began to attack the last strongholds of freedom. Not all the services run as they did yesterday, but London manages to get to work on time, one way or another. In the center of the city, the shops are open as usual. In fact, many of them are more open than usual. Dr. Paul Joseph Gibbles said recently that the nightly air raids have had a terrific effect upon the morale of the people of London. The good doctor is absolutely right. Today, the morale of the people is higher than ever before. They are fused together, not by fear, but by a surging spirit of courage the like of which the world has never known. They know that thousands of them will die, but they would rather stand up and face death than kneel down and face the kind of existence the conqueror would impose upon them. And they know, too, and are comforted by the thought that England is not taking its beating lying down. They are guarding the frontiers of freedom. It is hard to see 5 centuries of labor destroyed in 5 seconds. But London is fighting back. I am a neutral reporter. I have watched the people of London live and die ever since death in its most ghastly garb began to come here as a nightly visitor 5 weeks ago. I have watched them stand by their homes. I have seen them made homeless. I have seen them move to new homes. Determination, confidence, and high courage among the people of Churchill's Island. And they know that every night the RAF bombers fly deep into the heart of Germany, bombing munition works, aeroplane factories, canals, cutting the arteries which keep the heart of Germany alive. It is true that the Nazis will be over again tomorrow night, and the night after that, and every night. They will drop thousands of bombs, and they'll destroy hundreds of buildings, and they'll kill thousands of people. But a bomb has its limitations. It can only destroy buildings and kill people. It cannot kill the unconquerable spirit and courage of the people of London. Britain can take it.
There are some rare goings-on in Hackney these days. It's not so long ago we queued for dentures, but now the hospitals have got their teeth properly in and we queue to watch them nurse babies. Watch her drop it. No, not seriously, I mean. She's a nurse from the Mother's Hospital and knows her stuff. She's doing it because she wants us to know our stuff too. It's all part of Hackney's campaign to recruit more part-time hospital workers. She'll be bathing her soon. Blimey, that gives us a thrill, especially when some other poor soul will have to rub out the nappies. But her handwork's good, instructive and all. Makes you wonder how some of us managed. Ooh. Just think, 5 weeks old and a show baby already. That's what comes of being born in a Hackney hospital, never green behind the ears when we turn them out. That's how we breed them in Hackney. not her real mother, of course. She's a student nurse, but she's playing her part very well. There'll be more like her if we play our part too, but we mustn't all specialize in babies.
If there's one thing that I like, it's a burn up on my bike. A burn up with a bird up on my bike.
Meet the 59 Club of Hackney.
Oh, you're trying to a ton. A burn up on my bike, that's what I like.
Their leader is Father Bill, the Reverend William Shergold, affectionately nicknamed the Tun-Up Vicar. Members come from as far as Tunbridge Wells and Oxford, but last Saturday night was specially special. Superintendent Helkers, representing the Metropolitan Commissioner, explains.
On behalf of the Friendly Motorcycle Club, I have the honour to present to you this silver chalice, which I know you will cherish as a token of their appreciation and regard for you and your work.
It's a dressing room on wheels for many of the 2,000 footballers who each Sunday travel from all parts of the capital to Hackney Marshes in East London. With 108 pitches, the Marshes are London's biggest sports ground, but so popular is Sunday football that the teams have to book their pitches from 6 to 10 months ahead. Percent of the teams, whose players are from 16 to 40, are affiliated to the London Sunday Football Association. All equipment is provided by the men themselves, and they generally manage a smart turnout. Referees are chosen from a panel appointed by their respective leagues. A team lucky enough to get a dressing room shares it with their opponents. Typical, this, of the sporting spirit of these Londoners. The footballers come from all walks of life. Factory workers, accountants, salesmen, lorry drivers, even film technicians. Hackney Marshes on a Sunday morning are a testimony to that British love of sport which has become a byword throughout the world.
Thank you.
the East End was defined by strong community ties, and the population was surprisingly resilient. Propaganda films played on this, creating a defining image of the chirpy, cheery Londoner.
Full of beans, thumbs up. Oh, Bob's my uncle, thumbs up. Full of beans, Bob's my uncle, and thumbs up.
Here we see children at the Fern Street settlement in Bow. The settlement was and is a charity, and by tradition, local children small enough to pass through the wooden frame were given toys in exchange for a farthing. These were known as the Fern Street Bundles.
Men and women for civil defence. Auxiliary firemen, stretcher bearers, wardens, trained and auxiliary nurses, and all the other services. You want to know what to do in these days? Offer your services now to your nearest air raid warden. He will tell you what to do. Go to it! Biggest dropped on London so far, falls near St. Paul's Cathedral and buries itself in a 26-foot crater. And for 3 days, a party of men of the bomb disposal section risk their lives to dig it clear. By their disregard of danger, the bomb is conveyed to Hackney Marshes and blown up. The explosion makes a vast 100-foot crater. Simple facts in an epic story that typifies the high courage of men who defy Hitler's worst.
Hundreds of people have attended a service in East London to mark the 70th anniversary of the worst civilian disaster of World War II in Britain. 173 people, including 62 children, were crushed to death as panic spread through crowds trying to get into Bethnal Green tube shelter. They wrongly believed that the area was being bombed. Well, Andrew Plant was at the service at Bethnal Green tube station.
This was the largest civilian loss of life in a single accident during the entire Second World War. Those 173 people who died here did so because they thought they were escaping a German Luftwaffe attack. In fact, it turned out to be a false alarm. Now, such were the reporting restrictions at the time, so large was the censorship that it was barely reported then and barely remembered afterwards. Now, though, 70 years down the line, hundreds of people have turned out here today to pay their respects to the victims of the Bethnal Green tube station disaster.
In the air raids of World War II, the tunnels of Bethnal Green tube provided shelter for thousands of Londoners on dozens of occasions. But on the 3rd of March 1943, this place of safety became the scene of a terrible civilian disaster. As sirens sounded out the air raid alarm, hundreds of people flowed towards these steps. But as one lost their footing, those following began to tumble, not killed by bombs but crushed to death under an unstoppable wave of human bodies. 173 died, 62 of them children. The sirens later turned out to be a false alarm. Fears that the disaster would damage wartime morale meant reporting was censored. It was only 50 years later that the event was finally commemorated with this small plaque. Survivors, though, have returned every year to lay flowers. This was the largest loss of life in one incident during World War II, far more lives than any one German bomb ever managed to claim. Suffocated in just seconds as they tried to find a place of safety.
Now, there were around 500 people in the service here today, but it's taken many, many years to get to that stage. At the time, as I say, it was so underreported, no one really knew about it. And it was only in 1993 that that plaque was finally erected above the stairs behind me here. A few years later, it was taken down again during the refurbishment of the station, and survivors and the families of victims had to fight very, very hard to have it put back up. This is the stage they're at now. This is a part-finished memorial. You can see just how many flowers have been laid here today. They are all fresh. And over here, we have the names of all of the victims, too. I don't think we can get close enough to show you them, but it is striking when you read them just how many ages of the people who died are in single figures. So many children died here at that time. As I say, this isn't finished, though. There is an extra piece to be put up there, a set of inverted steps, which will, again, contain the names of all the people who died here. The people trying to get this memorial finished say they need around another £115,000, but they are hopeful they will get that completed this year.
Over a million of them. Some returned because they weren't happy in their refugee homes. Some because of difficulties about money to keep them there. But most of them returned because their parents were too lonely without them. Some children were sent away again, but many stayed at home and endured the nights of terror and destruction. Long nights in underground rooms packed with adults. Long nights of discomfort and disturbed sleep. Some shelters were warm and dry. Others were damp, airless, insanitary. They were often overcrowded. But people put up with the worst conditions to be safe. The British government and volunteer workers are struggling to improve these conditions.